For those who've abandoned hope, we'll restore hope and we'll welcome them into a great national crusade to make America great again.
I will be the greatest jobs president that God ever created.
We begin with breaking news. Our NBC News decision desk has confirmed that Donald Trump has reached the number of delegates needed to clinch the Republican nomination for president.
The American dream is dead. But if I get elected president, I will bring it back bigger and better and stronger than ever before, and we will make America great again. We are going to make our country great again. We're going to take our country back from these people. We're going to take it back.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next president of the United States, Donald Trump.
Thank you very much, everybody. Oh, if I knew they had these teleprompters, I would have used them. I'm starting to love those teleprompters. You know, it's interesting. It's much easier when you have a teleprompter, and I'm getting great reviews with the teleprompters. When you stand up and you just go at it, it's much more exciting, however, I want to tell you. I think this crowd, I know the folks from Colorado, and they're wild. I think if I used a teleprompter with this crowd, they'd be out of here fast. They'd say, let's get out of here. So I just want to thank, this is a tremendous crowd. We really appreciate it. Set up pretty quickly. Wow. So Colorado taught me a lot about politics. I learned a lot because polls came out that I was going to win Colorado and doing really well in Colorado and look good, and I was looking forward to it. And then all of a sudden, I didn't get the delegates. I said, but what happened to the vote? Do you remember? And I started to learn. You know, quick learner. I'm a quick learner, but that was an amazing week. Do you remember that? And we had some of you folks probably were out there with a little picketing, a little craziness, and I think they'll probably end up changing. I think they're going to change it next year, and I think you're going to go out and actually vote. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So you see what's happening, and I always say the system's rigged. It's rigged. And it's rigged against the people. It's not rigged for the special interests and the lobbyists and people that want certain things. I used to be one of them. Once I said, I'm running, all of a sudden I was like an outsider, a big outsider. But I'm glad I did it, because you know what we have? We have a movement going on like they haven't seen maybe ever in this country, according to what the pundits are saying. And I tell the story where numerous people, Bill O'Reilly, not so long ago, a few weeks ago, said, it may be the single greatest political phenomena that I've seen in my lifetime. He was talking about his lifetime. And I said, wow, that's a lot of phenomena you've seen. But numerous other people have said it, too. And here we stand, and there you stand and sit. Oh, you're able to sit. Oh, that's good. See, we supply chairs. How many people do that? Nobody else supplies chairs. Nobody else does that. Only Trump. Only Trump. That's good. These lights are so bright, I can hardly see who's out. That's a good crowd of people. Wow. That's great. And thank you. Thank you very much. But the system is rigged. And, you know, we went through the primary system, and we did have problems here because, you know, it wasn't a vote. And somebody said I did really well in the polls, and as soon as they saw how well I did in the polls, they went to a delegate system where they just appoint the delegates, and it's all right. It all worked out well. It all worked out well. You know what? In the end, it doesn't matter. Here we are, right? It doesn't matter. And you have some terrific people in the state. Very smart, very good. And they're going to really be helping us in November and before November. But I know how hard they're working in Colorado. And we're going to have tremendous, I think we're going to have a tremendous victory here. A couple of things before I really get going. Colorado, NRA, they're like synonymous. The NRA endorsed me. We're going to save your Second Amendment 100%. We're saving your Second Amendment. And I have to tell you, the NRA, these are terrific people. They're terrific people. They love the country. And they take a lot of heat. And they don't have the easiest job, I will tell you. But they love the country. Wayne and Chris and all of the other people I've met from the NRA. And they gave me, I think, the earliest endorsement they've ever given under these circumstances. And they gave me a very early endorsement. I was very honored by it. But I've gotten to know them. And they love our country. Okay? They love the Second Amendment, but they love our country. So you have to remember that about the NRA, because what they do is not easy. It's not easy. And they're saving the Second Amendment for you. So just remember that. And I'm going to be representing them very well in that regard. The other that we have to talk about is the evangelicals have been so amazing to me. We had an event the other day in New York, right? Any evangelicals in the room? Any evangelicals? But we had an event, and Ben Carson called me, who was a great guy. We love Ben Carson. And he called, and he said, you know, Donald, I'd love you to get with the evangelical leaders and Christian leaders all throughout the United States. Not a big deal. It'll take you maybe 15 or 20 minutes. But maybe you could see them, and maybe, you know, I think it's a good thing for you to do. Now, I've won with the evangelicals in many, many of the states, you know, South Carolina and Nevada and, like, all over the place. We've had great, great success. The South, Alabama, Arkansas, all over. And we've had unbelievable relationships and unbelievable success. But Ben wanted me to do it. As you know, when Ben got out, and he did really well, he was tough. He was a great competitor. He did really, really well when he ran. And he got out. And he called me, and he said, you know, I love what's going on. You have a movement going on. This isn't like a normal thing. This is a movement. I would love to endorse you. I said, Ben, I would love to have your endorsement. Plenty of people are calling saying we want to endorse you, and it's never been that important to me. I will say this. Bobby Knight in Indiana was important, right? Bobby Knight was important. But they said, I said, I'd love to endorse you. Then he comes up, and he goes, you know, I'd love to meet. Now, it's not a big deal. Maybe 150, maybe 200 people. And they could be here in a month in New York, but it would be a great thing. So all of a sudden, the time comes, and my people come in. They say, Mr. Trump, you won't believe it. It's packed. I said, I'll believe it, because it's always packed. But it's the largest group of clergy, ministers, pastors, evangelicals, Christians, the largest group they've ever had by far, over 1,000. And they wanted to know, could we take 2 to 3 hours? So this was the 50. Ben is one of the greatest salesmen I know, right? He said, small group, 15 minutes. Turned out to be a large group, 3 hours. But it was an amazing event. It was an amazing, and I learned, but it was just an incredible group of people. Franklin Graham was there, and Jerry Falwell Jr. from Liberty College, who's a fantastic guy, and so many people, friends. Real friends. Ralph Reed. We've had so many friends and people that have really been helpful to me. And I, as an example, Liberty College, everybody goes through Liberty College and we all make a speech. They have one of the most beautiful auditoriums, one of the most beautiful colleges I've ever seen, actually, and one of the most incredible auditoriums. And it holds 12,000 people, something like that. And I have the all-time record for attendance, which is really important. I got that 2 years ago. And I said, is it still intact? They said, yes. And I broke it this time. I said, good. That's good. And they had closed-circuit television because the room was too small, even as big as it was. In all the classrooms, all over the school, they had closed-circuit television. And we had an amazing time. And to get the support, and everybody went there. I think every candidate went there. and because of what it represents, such importance. And what happened is, in the end, Jerry calls, he says, you know, I want to endorse you. And that had such a huge impact because he's so respected, the school is so respected, the college, the university, so respected. And getting Jerry's support was such a great thing for me. So I just wanted to thank him, but I wanted to thank everybody because that was an amazing day we had about a week ago in New York City. It was packed and it was full of love. I will tell you that. It was full of love. So we'll talk for a little while about what's going on. I'm going to tell you some of the ideas that we want to have. I wrote down some notes in the plane because I didn't know I had this glass standing up here. In fact, it says right now, number one, number two. That's not meant for me. I want to thank Sarah Palin for being here because Sarah's great. Well, Sarah's a special person, and Sarah's another one where it came out of the blue. And she liked what I was saying. And she was also close with many of the other people that were running. And the word came back to me that Sarah was very interested, and we called her. And I can tell you, there were very, very disappointed people that I was running against, on the Republican side I'm talking about. And they were very, very disappointed when Sarah came out for me. I'll tell you, that was a big event. And she's so loyal and so amazing, and her family is so amazing. Her husband's an incredible guy. And for her to come here again and to say hello to you folks is just really something special. So I really appreciate that Sarah Palin was able to come. So I wrote some notes down. Sarah has a big group. We do love Sarah, right? Look at that. Wow. I'm not surprised. For good reason, by the way. So I want to give you some of the goals just quickly and easily, and you'll understand what they are. But, you know, the other night on television, I was looking, and certainly terrorism's actually number two, I was surprised. It'll probably be number one pretty soon, because what's going on today in Israel, there was a horrible killing, and then there was another horrible killing in Oregon, and there was another one. I mean, what's going on now is unbelievable. People that shouldn't be allowed in, people that shouldn't be here. And we're going to have strong borders, folks. We're going to have strong borders. We're going to have the wall. And we're going to let people come into our country that should come into our country, and they're going to come into our country legally. They're going to come in legally. And we want them to come in, but they're going to come into our country legally. But one of the things I noticed, because it was on one of the networks where they had them listed in order, and actually they had the economy number one, and I'm number one on the economy. That's good. And in fact, Rasmussen just came out with a poll yesterday afternoon, and Trump is number one. I'm up 4 points. Can you believe that's not right? That's nice. We're going to do very well. We're going to do. You know, in the primaries, one after one, bing, bing, bong, bing. And people said, what happened? Just one after another. And, you know, we have the right message. And I'm just the messenger. I'm doing a good job as a messenger, I will say, okay? But I'm just a messenger, believe me. It's what I'm saying. It's what I'm saying about what's going on. And it's getting stronger. I think the message is getting stronger. We're being destroyed by trade, which we'll talk about. We're being destroyed at our borders, which we'll talk about. And we're allowing people to come into our country from Syria and other places that shouldn't be allowed to come into our country. We have no idea who they are, where they're from. We have no idea what's going on. They have no paperwork. They have no documentation. They could be ISIS. I used to say they're probably not, but now I say many of them probably are. You see what's happening in Germany. You see what's happening in Sweden. You see what's happening in some of these countries where they're taking them in. It's a nightmare. And I have a bigger heart than anybody, or as big as anybody in this room. And I will tell you, we're going to do safe zones in Syria. We're going to get other people to pay for them. The Gulf states have a lot of money. People don't ask them to pay. Trump is going to ask them to pay. You're going to have to pay. And we'll get it done. Believe me, we'll get it done. So one thing I just wanted to say, we're going to repeal and replace Obamacare. Healthcare was third on the list. And honestly, I was surprised to see it. health care on this list. It was the economy, it was terrorism, and it was health care, which tells you something. You know, in Texas, they go through Blue Cross Blue Shield. They had a 60% increase. You're going to have an increase like you've never seen before on November 1st. Now, they're trying to delay the increase till after the election. We can't let that happen, because this increase is an election-changing increase. Now, I hope we don't even need that. But this is an election-changing increase that you're going to get. I'm hearing numbers like higher than the numbers in Texas. So 60% in Texas going through Blue Cross, Blue Shield, you got the Obamacare, 60% increase. Think of it. Unimaginable. Well, it's also horrible because your premiums are going up, your deductibles are through the roof, and unless you die a really, really severe long-term death, they're not going to use it because your deductibles are so high. Your deductibles are through the roof, and people don't even get to use it. So they're paying more than ever, and they don't get to use it. And we're going to change that. We're going to repeal and replace Obamacare, and we're going to get something so much better and so much less expensive. Okay. I already talked about the fact we're going to save the Second Amendment, right? That's a biggie. We're going to eliminate job-killing regulations. The regulations in this country are killing us. We're going to have massive tax reform and simplification, a big lowering of the taxes, the biggest of anybody by far. Hillary Clinton is raising your taxes. She's raising your taxes substantially, and there won't be simplification. We're lowering your taxes. You watch what's going to happen with the economy. We're lowering your taxes, big league, and tremendous simplification. We're lowering business taxes. We're going to allow money. We have trillions of dollars outside of the United States owned by, really, the corporations have this money. They can't get it back into the country. And everybody agrees, Republicans, Democrats, that it should come back in. They can't make a deal. That's a deal that would take 5 minutes sitting around the room. But nobody, there's no leadership. So we have trillions of dollars. Who would not want to make that deal? They say $2.5 trillion. I say it's over $5 trillion. But whatever it is, it's massive. And companies, corporate inversion. Companies are leaving the United States because taxes are too high, but they're also leaving to get their money. They can't get their money back in, so they leave to get their money. So it's crazy. We're going to appoint Supreme Court justices who you're going to be very happy with. Such a big thing. And these are justices that will uphold the Constitution of the United States and fully uphold it, right? And you know what's going to happen? And I sort of get a kick. You have these people. Look, it was a tough campaign. It was a brutal campaign. Some of the people that do this professionally said it was the most brutal campaign in the history of politics in this country. I don't know if that's true or not, but we started off with 17 people, and there were a lot of bad things said, and there was one person that came out. And I understand. You know, I understand. But they were really nasty to me, and I was really nasty to them. And some of them just can't understand the importance of a victory for the Republicans. And one of the best things we can say are the judges, because, you know, we can talk about the strong military. We're going to do all of the things. But the judges, we're going to appoint at least three. You have Scalia, who is great. And he's who would have thought that was going to happen? That wasn't going to be for many years. And all of a sudden, Justice Scalia was gone. So you have that one before you start. And then you probably have two more. You could even have three. And you could even have four more. I mean, frankly, you got a lot. Probably going to be a record in the history of this country for a president. Could have as many as you could have, including Justice Scalia. You could have as many as five. Probably we'll have three. But that's the difference between having our country as a great country and having Venezuela, okay? And you see what's happening over there. Believe me. Where they're fighting over loaves of bread in the street. I mean, that's a tremendous thing. And what I did, because I've only been doing this for 12 months, so what I've done, in fact, they said one of the articles had, it was 211 years of experience. You know, they added up everybody. They had 211 years versus 11 months. And look who won. Isn't that good? I mean, don't we get credit for that? I think experience is a great thing, but I think we're getting tired of the experience because the experience wasn't working, folks, right? But because of the fact that I haven't been out there as a politician, people know me, but I haven't been out there as a politician, a lot of people have said to me, Senator Sessions, who's a fantastic man, and others, they've said it wouldn't be bad. And I actually went in with the idea because I was getting criticized. They said, well, what happens if he appoints judges that we don't like? So I went to the Federalist Society, which is sort of the gold standard. Now, Hillary Clinton said the gold standard of trade deals is TPP. Now she's taking that back. You saw that, right? When you mentioned TPP will destroy you, folks. It will destroy you. It'll take any vestige that we still have left in our country. It will destroy you. And she said it. Now, what happened is when she heard me being very critical of it, she realized I was right. So she said now she's against it, but she's going to approve it in 2 seconds if she ever won. And that will be as bad or worse than NAFTA, which was, by the way, signed by her husband. Okay? So we'll be. So I went out and I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pick 10 judges or 11 judges and we'll see what happens. And I picked 11, gotten from the Federalist Society, run through by a lot of great politicians that I know that are highly respected, senators and congressmen and great people. And loved, went through Heritage, who's great, Jim DeMint and the group, who's a great guy. Jim is a great guy. We like Jim. Listen to you people. Wow. He is a great guy. Then we ran him through Heritage, and these are 11 people. I think I'm going to pick 4 more, so I have 15. And I'll pick from that list or people like that, exactly like that. And we're going to have great judges. And it had a big impact. But you still have people out there, and it's just one of those things. You know, one of the things I'm most proud about is that in the history of the Republican Party, with 17 people running, I had the most votes of anybody that's ever run in the primaries. We had almost 14 million votes. Think of it. Won 37 states. Next time it's going to be Colorado, by the way. Colorado is not in that 37. Don't worry. If it was, I'd still be here today. But we had 37 states, and we had the largest number of votes. Now, when you think about it, almost 14 million votes, and it wasn't even close. Ronald Reagan, who we love, you have the Bushes, you have Dwight D. Eisenhower, Richard Nixon, everybody. You have everybody. Just so much more than anybody else. Wasn't even close. But think of it. They would run against 2 people, 1 person, 4 people. When you break that record and you're running against 17 very capable people, that's really a record that is pretty amazing, more amazing than even just winning. So I was very honored by that. We're going to protect our country from terrorism, okay, folks? We're going to protect our country from terrorism. We are going to be so tough. We are going to be so smart and so vigilant. And we're going to get it so that people turn in people when they know there's something going on. Like in San Bernardino, people saw bombs all over these people's floors. They had bombs all over the floor. They saw it. People saw it. And they talked about racial profiling and profiling. We didn't want to turn them in because we didn't want to get accused of profiling. Give me a break. You know what that is? That's a lawyer telling them, listen, you better say that because otherwise you're in big trouble. But people have to turn people in. And if they don't turn them in, we're going to have so many of these things. What happened in Orlando is disgraceful, disgraceful that a thing like that can happen. And then they don't want to mention what happened. We have a president that doesn't want to mention what really happened. It's called radical Islamic terrorism, right? That's what happened. And you have crooked Hillary Clinton that didn't want to mention it either, but we shamed her into it, but she still hasn't mentioned it. She said, I will say, and then she didn't quite use the expression the way it should be, but I will say radical Islam. I will say it. Okay. But she's never said it yet. She said she will say it because we shamed her into it. Just like we shamed her into going against TPP. Was that so, the only reason she didn't do it? She'll do it, but not for the election, because people are sick and tired of being ripped off with our jobs leaving our states, with our jobs leaving our country, with the money. They get the money, they get the jobs, we get nothing. We get unemployment. That's what we get. We get unemployment and no taxes. And, folks, we can solve that situation so easily. That situation is so easily solved. I've been watching for a long time, and I've been watching it very, very closely, how the government is trying to stop jobs from leaving our country. I left yesterday New Hampshire, where I see building after building just got wiped out. New England, one of the worst places in terms of that. Upstate New York, a disaster. Pennsylvania, a disaster. Maryland, Connecticut, all states that I won in massive numbers. I mean, I had a series of states, five or six states in a row, where I won every single county in every single state. A lot of that, thank you. You know, starting with New York and starting with all of these great states, and there was love. I went to West Virginia, and Hillary said, we're going to put the miners out of business. We're going to put the mines and the miners out of business. She then went, got a couple of miners back there. She then went to West Virginia. Can you believe it? And she apologized, but the statement was made, folks. That's what she's going to do. These are liars. These are liars. She tried to convince people. She tried to convince people that what she said, she didn't mean, let's go. Remember, she was sitting down with a coal miner in West Virginia whose family's been devastated. And I had tremendous — we had an event in West Virginia, and it was very interesting, because after I won New York, for some reason, I said, we're going to put the miners back to work. And I didn't say it even for a reason. I didn't even know which was next, and West Virginia was going to be on the list. But West Virginia, we have such a lead. I think we have a 25 or a 29-point lead in West Virginia, as an example, and in other places. In other places, we're doing great in Pennsylvania. We're doing great in Ohio. We're doing great sort of everywhere, much better than the press would have you believe, although the polls have really gotten much tighter in the last few days. But, I mean, much, much tighter. So we're going to win what? Colorado, we got to win this one. Man, oh, if we lose this. But, and we do have to win Colorado. I'll be back a lot. Don't worry about it. I'll be back a lot. It's going to be, I mean, I see the poll. We're either even or 1 point up in Colorado. So we got to lift that up a little bit. But we're going to be back. We'll be back a lot. No, it's very important. It's a very important state in terms of winning the election. A very, very important state. We have states where, you know, we have a tremendous lead and where they have a tremendous lead. One of the things that's happening with us is that we play, meaning us, meaning me, play in a lot of states that a Republican, more traditional Republican, doesn't play. We're going to do great in states like Michigan. I think we're going to do great. They've been devastated by job loss. They've been devastated. I think we're going to do great in Illinois. Normally a Republican, if somebody else won, they would never go to Illinois. I'm going to spend a lot of time in Illinois. I'm going to spend a lot of time in Michigan. I think we're going to win. I've been talking about cars moving to Mexico, car companies, Ford, moving to Mexico for 2 years, long before I even knew we'd be in this position. Nobody has been better to the state of Michigan and to the car industry than me in terms of what I'm saying and what I'm going to do to get the car companies back, number one, and to keep them from moving, because they're going to continue to move like you've never seen before if I don't win. We're going to have job loss like you've never seen ever before if I don't win. So I think we're going to play great in Michigan. Even in Connecticut, there was a poll that came out. This is a state that I love. I have so many friends that live in Connecticut. But this is a state that a Republican, a traditional Republican, would never spend one afternoon in terms of getting votes. And I'm going to spend a lot of time in Connecticut. And we may even give a shot to New York and California, because we have tremendous crowds. We're getting 30, 35,000 people going to these places. So we're going to play in a lot of states that normally, obviously, Ohio and Pennsylvania and Florida, those are your states that everybody says you have to win, you have to win. But I think we have a lot more leeway than anybody else running for office from the Republican Party. And I think we're going to do great in these places. We want to uphold, totally uphold, the rule of law. Not being upheld. Not being upheld. Okay? We want to cut down on the unbelievable crime that's pouring in and the crime rate generally, okay? We want to keep our children safe. We want to keep ourselves safe, but we have to. We have to. So many friends of mine, Jamil, as an example, Shaw, his son was killed by a person that came into this country, an illegal immigrant, should have never, ever been here. Kate, as you remember from San Francisco, shot viciously by somebody that was sent out of the country 5 times and will probably get off. I see the lawyer and they're saying, oh, maybe it wasn't him, and oh, it's terrible. It'll go on for years and years and years, what happened to Kate, and so many others, so many others. And we're going to have a country where we can be free to walk around and free to walk the streets and free to look at the beautiful Golden Gate Bridge with your father, like Kate was doing, and then shot from nowhere. We're going to have a country that's going to be safe again. Just remember that. We're going to have a country that's going to be safe. And we're not going to play games. We're not going to be politically correct, perhaps. But we're going to have a country that's going to be safe. We're going to make our government so important, responsible to the people, not to the special interests. The special interests control your government, folks. The special interests. I mean, you see what happened today where Bill Clinton goes in the other day into an airplane. Just happened to be. Oh, just a coincidence, you know. He just happened to be at the airport at this time. Think of it. Just happened to be at the airport. You know, when I first heard the story, I said, no, no, you're kidding. I don't believe it. I thought somebody was joking. But it's not a joke. It's not a joke. It's a very serious thing. And to have a thing like that happen is so sad. And as you know, Hillary is so guilty. She's so guilty. I mean, you can read them right off here. And how that's not being pursued properly. And I think that he really opened it up. He opened up a Pandora's box, and it shows what's going on, and it shows what's happening with our laws and with our government. But if you think that he just happened to be at the airport, because nobody really, and he may have, and honestly, he may have left and gone someplace, but it seems like, you know, he's talking about golf and grandchildren. I love my grandchildren so much. But if I talk about them for more than about 9 or 10 seconds, you know, what do we, I love my grandchildren. I love that one. I love that one. I love, love, love that one. And look at the beautiful, I love these kids. After that, what are you going to say, right? I love those kids. They're the great 8. I love them. I love my children. I love my children. My children are going to be speaking at the convention. My children are all going to be speaking. Ivanka, Tiffany, Don, Eric, they're going to be speaking. My wife is going to be speaking at the convention. We're going to have a great time. And then you have to talk about golf for the rest of the time. And, you know, I love golf, but after talking for a couple of minutes, it's hard to talk about it much longer than that. And above all, what we're going to do, so important, we're going to put America first. I have to say it. We don't put America first. We don't put America first. We don't put America first. And we have to. So, when we look at what's going on in our country, and when we see all of the mistakes that are being made, and we see all of the corruption and all of the horrendous politicians, and by the way, I have to tell you, some great politicians, too. I've met some people that are great people. These are great people. And they love the country, and they're there for the right reasons. But you meet so many that aren't. You just meet so many that aren't. And we do deal in a rigged system. It's a rigged system. And I learned so much during the primaries. I won, as an example, I won in New Orleans. I went to make a speech, Louisiana. I was in New Orleans, made a speech. I then went into Louisiana, flew into the airport in Louisiana. There was this massive hangar, and it was the night before the election. And I gave a speech, and it was just great. We had so many, thousands and thousands of people. The airport, the hangar was packed. It was a massive room, probably 3 times, 4 times bigger than this room. It was packed. And that was the night before the election. I said, how can I lose? How can I lose? And I didn't lose. I won. And I wasn't expected to win. You know, I won a lot of things that I wasn't expected to do. And I won. Easily, but I won. And everything was good.
And then about 2 weeks later, they're showing delegate counts to me. Sir, you did this, you did this, you did that. I said, oh, that's good. What about this one? That's wrong, because I won that state, right? Yes, sir, you did. But I have less delegates than the people that lost. And that's when I realized it's rigged, folks. It's rigged. But I got smart fast. I got smart very fast. And one of the things that we're going to focus on, and we're going to focus on more than almost anything, because, you know, look, we need safety. We need borders. We're going to have the wall. We're building the wall. And the wall is necessary. And we're going to have a great relationship with Mexico. It's going to be very important. But we're going to build the wall. Mexico's going to pay for the wall. You understand that. No, they're going to pay for the wall. And we're going to have trade, and we're going to have lots of good things happen with Mexico. Mexico doesn't like us right now. Mexico doesn't respect our leaders. Remember Sergeant Tamburisi? Remember? They couldn't get him out of prison, right? Greta was very helpful. I think I was helpful. At least I helped them. But couldn't get him out. And he was there for a long time, long, long time, in one of the meanest, worst prisons in the world, they say. Horrible place. We couldn't get him out. Should have gotten him out. I'm not sure the president even made a phone call. I will tell you something. When things like that happen, if I'm president, I know they say, oh, it's not presidential, you shouldn't do that. But things like that happen, if I'm president, I promise you, I'll be making phone calls, folks. I'm going to be making phone calls. I mean, I'm not really sure that he ever even made a phone call. Certainly, there was no rush. It's sort of like the horrible deal that we made with Iran. Iran has become a power. We have made, over the last few years, over between Hillary Clinton and John Kerry, who made — it was one of the worst negotiators I've ever seen. How about he goes out and he breaks his leg in a bicycle race? Can you believe this? He's in the middle of negotiating the deal. And he's got all this stuff on. He's got the whole deal, the companies, the whole deal, the helmet. He's got everything going. I promise you, I swear to you, I will never be in a bicycle race during a major negotiation. Never. But how about that deal? And if you look, Iran was a country that was in deep trouble. They were doing badly. And then we took the sanctions off. And we should have never taken the sanctions off before we finished the deal. We took the sanctions off before. You know why they're great negotiators? They said, we will not negotiate unless you take the sanctions off. And our guy said, okay. That's what they say. And when they said that, why didn't we say we want our prisoners back? Okay? Because our prisoners were there for years after that started. It's like 101, Trump, the art of the deal, right? 101. We say, okay, and we took the sanctions off. We got nothing for that. They agreed to sit down. They were dying. They were choking. And instead of saying, we'll take the sanctions off, but there's two things. Number one, you got to release our prisoners right now. Number two, we're not going to give you $150 billion back, okay? We're not giving it back. And they're going to say, no way, no way. You know, they're great negotiators. The Persians are great negotiators. They're going to say, no way. In a million years, no way. Then you leave. See, Kerry never got up and left, right? Never got up and left. Then you leave. And by the time you get back to the United States, don't even get off the plane. It's going to turn around and go back. You'll have your prisoners, and you won't have to pay the $150 billion back. So sad. Because I'm all for making deals. I think it's great. You know, to make deals on nuclear is a good thing, not a bad thing. But you got to make good deals. This is a deal that's ruinous to Israel, in my opinion. I think this deal is a disaster for us. But it's a disaster, and even a bigger disaster, for Israel. So we're going to have great deals made. We're going to make smart deals. If you think about it, so you had Iran, which was choking, which had no — I mean, they were literally going to bust up. I mean, they were at a point where they were going to — but remember the riots? And then Obama gave the regime solace, and they just took care of those riots so easily. There was a time when that could have all changed. It could have all changed. So instead, we have a power, a real power, that's fighting us. How about we make a deal there in Yemen? We're fighting them in Yemen. We make a deal, but we don't make a deal. We don't talk about Yemen. And when asked about why we didn't discuss Yemen, because we're fighting Iran on the other side, right? We're going like this. Well, why didn't you put that into the deal? And Kerry said it was too complicated. What's complicated? What's complicated? We're giving all this stuff away. And they'll have nuclear weapons. They can buy nuclear weapons with the money they have. They become a real power. And now they're on the side of Assad. And, you know, that whole debate we'll have to talk about because, you know, I disagree with a lot of the things that a lot of people have been saying about the Middle East and about what we're doing. You know, it's very interesting. We spend tremendous, tremendous, tremendous amounts of money protecting other nations that are very, very wealthy. Japan, Germany, Saudi Arabia, South Korea. We spend money. In South Korea, we have 28,000 soldiers on the line between them and the madman, right? We have 28,000. Every time he acts up, we start sending our ships, our planes, our boats. You know, you turn on one of those ships, it costs you $2 million, right? Just, I would say, don't turn on the engine. Save the money. Don't, please. The captain would say, sir, would you like to hear the engine? I'd say, if it was me, I'd say, no, just save the money, relax. The engine's fine. But it's true. It's true. I mean, that's what they are. It's a different thinking, right? A lot of business people in here, it's a different thinking. There's so much waste. There's so much fraud. There's so much abuse. So we spend all of this money, and I don't want to see them arm, ideally. I don't want to see them arm. But you always have to be prepared to walk, like Kerry should have walked with Iran. He should have walked, and then he should have said, double up the sanctions, and believe me, you'll be back there within 2 days. All right? And most of that's flying time. No, that's what he should have. But you have to be prepared to walk. He never walked, okay? So he never walked. So what happened with Kerry and what happens with all of us is we have the wrong people. We have the greatest negotiators in the world. Anywhere in the world, we're the greatest negotiators. But we don't use them. We use political hacks. So with Germany, with Japan, with Saudi Arabia, which has nothing but money, if we weren't protecting Saudi Arabia, Turkey? Are you from Turkey, sir? Good. Congratulations. I actually have a very nice job in Turkey. He's saying, please mention Turkey. Okay. I think he's friend. Are you friend or foe? Huh? I think he's friend. But no, it's true. Turkey. And I do. We have investments in Turkey. I have investments in a lot of different places. But I will tell you, and Turkey, by the way, should be fighting ISIS. I hope to see Turkey go out and fight ISIS, because ISIS has, in a certain sense, taken very serious advantage of Turkey. They've taken advantage. And Turkey has a tremendously powerful military, and they could wipe ISIS out by themselves. I would love to see that. How would we love to see that? Because it looks like it was ISIS that did all the damage in the airport. That was Turkey. So I think Turkey is all of a sudden going to change and say, that's enough of this. And Turkey has the power to do it, and they have the power to do it all by themselves. They could do it, and they could do it pretty swiftly, too. So with all of these countries, we pay for the military big portions, disproportionately. So I said, we have to get them to pay us. And I have a very good plan. I was right on NATO. You know, when I first gave my — when they asked me about NATO, and I first said my statement, it's obsolete, and they don't cover terrorism like they should. And on top of that, the countries of NATO aren't paying what they're supposed to be paying. It was on television. Everybody smiled. Oh, that's so funny. Funny. Like we're a joke. Funny. Then about 4 days later, they said, you know, Trump was sort of right. You have these people that study NATO, but they're so close to it. They're so totally close to it. They can't see the forest for the trees. Does that make sense? So about 4 days later, they said, you know, I said NATO's obsolete. And they don't study, they don't have terrorism the way it should have. They don't even have the right countries for terrorism, actually. But they don't have terrorism as a big thing. And we're paying for so much, and a lot of these countries aren't paying what they're supposed to be paying, many of them. So we're protecting all these countries. They're not even paying us what they're supposed to be paying, and that's too little. So I made that statement. And I'm telling you, for 3 or 4 days, it was like, Donald Trump doesn't know. Now, I'm not saying I'm an expert on NATO. Nobody ever asked me about NATO before. But I have a lot of common sense, and I have a lot of business sense. I built this great company. I built an unbelievable company. I have business sense. So 3 or 4 days later, all of a sudden, they start saying, you know, what Trump just said makes a lot of sense. Gee, now they — so 2 weeks ago, I pick up the Wall Street Journal. And on the front page of the Wall Street Journal, headline, NATO to develop new unit for terrorism. That's what I told him. And then it announced one of the top people in the world. It is NATO, right? But one of the top people to be put in charge. Okay? I said, that's what I said. Now, my name was mentioned in the bottom. They said, Donald Trump complained. Oh, great. I didn't complain. I said NATO is obsolete because of that. That didn't mean abandon NATO. It didn't mean anything. Either you fix it or you have to develop something having to do with terrorism, but it's obsolete. We have a different world today than we had 40 years ago and 60 years ago. We have a different world. Even the Soviet Union is now Russia, but let's say Russia's damn strong, so leave it for that. But you know what? It's a different world. And I see things that a lot of people don't. I said, take the oil. You shouldn't. I also said, don't go into Iraq. It's a big mistake. You're going to destabilize the Middle East. They went in. But I also said, don't go out the way we went out. We just went out. President Obama announced we're going to be out by a certain date. The only thing deceptive about that was the enemy said, nobody would have said that. So I don't think they believed it. And then the date happened. We left. And, you know, this all led to the formation of ISIS and lots of other things. But I said, when you go out, take the oil, right? How long have I been saying that? For years. And you know, on television, they say, before I did that, they say, what is your plan? What is a plan? I said, I don't want to really say, because I have a really good chance of being elected. And I don't want to talk about it. You know, General Patton didn't sit on television and say, let's see, on July 16th, we're going to attack ISIS from behind. Were they going to knock out a battalion over here, and we're going to drop so many bombs at this quadrant, and we're going to get, here's my plan. And by the way, everything, do you ever notice? Everything we do, it's always hard because we always have to say. So I say to the television people, I don't want to really tell you. I was on Bill O'Reilly the other night. I said, Bill, I don't want to really talk about it. Believe me, I know what I'm going to do. We're going to knock the hell out of ISIS. I don't want to really too much talk about it. But here's the problem. You got to get elected, so you got to talk about it. It's a little defective. You got to get elected, so you got to talk about it. So I said I'd go in with NATO, and I'd make NATO do something. And I'd go in, and I'd also get all of the countries around there that are really involved and have to be involved. And I'd go, and you got to clean it up, because these people are chopping off heads. They're drowning people. We're not allowed to waterboard, right? We can't waterboard. They're allowed to chop off heads. They're allowed to drown people. I said the other day, when they go home and they're together, and they just chopped off 50 heads, drowned 200 people. And then they say, in the United States, they don't allow waterboarding. They think we are so stupid. They think we are so weak. They have no respect for us whatsoever. And remember this, the only thing they understand is strength. They don't understand kindness. They don't understand political correctness. The only thing they understand is strength and toughness. And we're weak. We're weak. And Hillary is weak as you get. Hillary is a weak person. She's a weak person. They will not understand Hillary. They want her to get in so badly. The last person they want to see become president of the United States, believe me, is Donald Trump. I can tell you that. It's the last person. They have dreams at night, and their dreams are that Hillary Clinton becomes president of our country, believe me. So we need to show toughness. We need to show strength. We have to level the playing field. We don't have a level playing field. We don't fight to win anymore. We don't win anymore. We don't win with the economy. We got China ripping us off. We have Japan ripping us off. We have Mexico beating us at the border, beating us on trade, taking all of our companies. I mean, they're taking tremendous numbers of companies. It's unbelievable. I think one of the reasons I won Indiana is that the air conditioning company, Carrier, announced they were leaving. They're going to fire 1,400 people who went to my speeches. They were all over the place. Every time I said, who's here from Carrier? All these hands would be raised. 1,400 people fired viciously and stupidly, because Carrier was moving, and they're from Indianapolis. Carrier was moving to Mexico. I think it had a huge, because I won. You remember, that was going to be the firewall for the other people that were running against me. And it was a firewall for me. I won with a landslide, right? Now, having Bobby Knight helped a lot, but I will tell you, they and New York and New England and every place, Pennsylvania, big league, we have our companies leaving. So that happens. We're going to stop that. We're going to stop that cold. And we're going to be so strong. And we're going to be so smart. And we're going to start winning again. We're going to start winning like we have never won before. We don't win anymore as a country. We don't win for our vets. We're going to take care of our vets, by the way. We don't win for our vets. We don't win for anything. We don't win for our pride. We don't win anymore. And it's going to stop. We're going to be victorious in so many different ways. As an example, Common Core. We're bringing our education back locally. We're getting rid of Common Core. We're getting rid of Common Core. We're going to bring our education local. Our education system is a mess, and a big reason is Common Core. So we're going to start winning again, folks. We're going to win with our military. We're going to win for our vets. We're going to win with education. We're going to win with health care. We're going to win big, big, big with trade. We're not going to have these deficits of $500 billion a year losses. We have with China $505 billion a year. They laugh at us. And everyone talks about free trade. I was asked the other day, they said, well, what's your, I know free trade so much. I know free trade, fair trade. I can give you 20 different names, okay? They said, well, what's your definition? What do you like? I said, I like trade where we make great deals for the United States. That's what I like. That's my definition. That's my definition of trade. I know every form of trade. I know every form of taxation. We're going to make great deals for the United States. We have the greatest negotiators in the world. We don't use them. We use political hacks. We're going to make great deals for the United States. So we're going to bring our money back. We right now owe China $1.8 trillion. We owe Japan $1.6 trillion. Think of it. Japan sends us millions of cars, and we owe them $1.6 trillion. You know what I call that? A magic act in reverse. It's like a magic act. So, folks, we're going to start winning again. We're going to win so much that the people of Colorado are going to be sick of winning. You're going to say, oh, I can't stand it. This guy, this president, he wins too much. We're not used to it. We can't take it. And your representatives and our great head of the Republican Party, who is a great guy, by the way, and I thank you for introducing me, I'm going to get calls in the White House. Mr. President, please, sir, please, we don't want to win this much. We're winning too much. My people in Colorado are going crazy. We just don't want to win. Not that much, just a little bit. I'll say, no way. We're going to win, 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 and we're going to make America great again, okay? So I want to thank you all. I love you, folks. Get out there. Get out there and vote. We got to get out there and vote. And I want to thank you. Thank you, everybody. I love you, folks. Thank you very much. Thank you.